It may be a mistake to start the video off like this, but the first thing I want to say about the VR performance of the RX 9060 XT is it's better than I thought it was going to be.
Wow.
That being said, getting started testing it was a little rough. Let me explain. The first game I fired up to test the 9060 XT was The Walking Dead Saints and Sinners, and right out the gate, I was getting some super annoying hitching. I'd be walking along for 5 or 10 seconds, and then all of a sudden everything would freeze for several seconds, and then snap back into motion again. If this was just a one-off thing, then of course it wouldn't be an issue. But this happened every 5 or 10 seconds while trying to play a game. To see if this was just an issue with The Walking Dead, I fired up several other games, and same thing. Every 5 or 10 seconds the game would freeze, and then resume, making them completely unplayable. I of course tried all the simple solutions first. I rebooted my PC, as well as my Quest 3, and even lowered settings in the game to see if there was a particular setting the 9060 XT was just struggling with. But no matter what I did, the hitching remained. Yes, I used a Quest 3 headset for all my testing for this video, and if you'd like to know the exact specs of my test PC, you can find them in the video description. But yeah, after several hours of troubleshooting, I finally decided to try rolling back my GPU drivers. Up until this point, I had been using AMD's most current Adrenaline driver, 25.11.1, and so I rolled it back one version to their 25.10.1 driver, but the hitching persisted. I then rolled the driver back one more version to 25.9.1, and that seemed to do the trick, because I didn't get any more hitching after that. I then started in on testing The Walking Dead again, and ran into another problem. The first 10 or so minutes of playing a game, things would be great, but then these weird horizontal artifacts that stretched across my entire field of view would appear. If I quit out of Questlink and restarted it, these lines would go away, but only for another 10 or so minutes before reappearing. Now I needed to find a way to fix this problem. So I did what I think all of us do in these kinds of situations. I prayed it would be miraculously fixed. No, just kidding. I googled the problem and really quickly found if you turn off sliced encoding in the Oculus debug tool, this issue completely disappears. From what I was able to find online, this problem seems to be limited to AMD's Radeon 9000 series GPUs when using Questlink. And while yes, it is annoying, it at least has a really simple solution. At this point, games were finally running smoothly, so once again I began testing The Walking Dead Saints and Sinners, and using the settings you see on screen now, I was able to play the game at 80Hz, and visually the game looked fantastic. The 9060 XT had no problem at all running Beat Saber at 120Hz at the settings you see on screen now. And it also had no problem with my personal favorite VR shooter, Contractors. Both games ran very smooth and visuals were sharp and crisp. Next up is a game I'm testing for the very first time, because it wasn't out yet the last time I tested a GPU in VR, and that is Forefront. This footage is from some of my very first matches I ever played in this game, and as you can clearly see, I suck at it. I'm pretty sure Forefront was designed to run on standalone VR and then ported to PC, so this one was no challenge at all for the 9060 XT, which ran the game at 120Hz at a render resolution of 4704x2528. I don't know if the game being in early access has anything to do with it, but Forefront has no adjustable graphics settings, which seemed a little weird to me, but it did end up making my job super easy. I was able to run Half-Life Alyx using its high fidelity performance option at 4192 by 2240, but also had to lower the refresh rate to 72Hz for this. While the game ran great for the most part at these settings, watching back the gameplay I recorded, I feel like I could have lowered the render resolution one or two notches, which would have given us a little more performance headroom and prevented moments like these where the frame rate momentarily drops in half. At the same time, these moments were super brief, and honestly, I didn't even notice them while I was playing, which is why I ultimately decided to just roll with these settings. As always, you do not have to use the settings I use. I'm always trying to get the best visuals I can, even if it means lowering the frame rate like this. Me personally, I'd much rather play a game at 72Hz and have sharp, crisp visuals than play at 90 or 120Hz with blurry or muddy looking graphics. You are, of course, 100% free to change your settings to fit the gameplay experience you want to have. My main goal in these GPU VR performance videos is to simply give you an idea of what a particular GPU is capable of, and then let you do with that information what you will. Another game I'm testing for the very first time, and was able to run at 4192 by 2240 at 72Hz, is Arken Age. As you can see looking at the performance headroom graph, I was super close to the limits of what the 9060 XT is capable of at the settings I settled on. But just like with Half-Life Alyx, visually the game looked great and gameplay was smooth the vast majority of the time. The next game in the 72Hz 4192 by 2240 render resolution club is Lone Echo 2. Although to keep the render resolution this high, I did have to turn the in-game settings down to medium. That said, even at medium quality settings, this game still looks really nice, especially when the render resolution is this high.
And here we have the luxury suite. It's a far cry from my old room on the Kronos, but I think I've managed to spruce it up a bit.
This next one is for all the sim racers out there who I'm sure are going to be horrified to learn I tested Assetto Corsa Competizione using an Xbox controller and not a racing wheel. Despite my lack of using the proper peripherals for this game, the 9060 XT ran this one at 3936 by 2112 at 72Hz, using the in-game settings listed on screen now. And while our performance headroom was once again pretty close to running out, the 9060 XT kept our frame rate at 72 FPS the entire time, so gameplay felt good. Behemoth is another new game I've added to my testing suite, and the 9060 XT ran this one really well at 3936 by 2112 at 72Hz, with most of the game's graphics settings on high. The worst performance I saw was when getting up close and personal with enemies, where the performance headroom dropped down to around 20 or 30% remaining. Most of the rest of the time, the performance headroom was around 40 to 50%. Even when I was fighting the game's first of the three behemoths.
Drive your blade into that weak point.
Yet another new title to the lineup is Alien Rogue Incursion. And this one I also ran at 3936 by 2112 at 72Hz. As for the in-game graphics settings, the 9060 XT was only able to keep us at our target frame rate with things at medium. As you can see, this left the visuals looking a little jaggy around the edges, which I'm not super thrilled about, but as you know, my goal is to get the best looking visuals I can while still maintaining a playable frame rate, and this is where I felt the 9060 XT topped out in this game. The Metro Awakening is another new game in my testing suite, and it ran pretty well on the 9060XT at 3936 by 2112 at 72 Hz using a mixture of high and medium in-game graphics settings. Unfortunately, the section of the game I decided to hit record on was just a bunch of exploring, trying to find ammo, filters for my gas mask, and other useful loot. So I don't have any exciting gameplay to show you, but you can at least see that when using the settings I did, we had a solid 72 FPS and plenty of performance headroom available for when things in the game get a little bit spicier.
It just exists, and its rules change before you can understand them. So that it can kill you and eat your soul.
Now you're talking souls.
Up next, we have yet another new title, Into the Radius 2. I've tested the first Into the Radius game many times in past GPU VR performance videos, but this is my first time playing and testing the second game, so those of you who are familiar with Into the Radius 2 will recognize from this gameplay footage that I'm only just starting out. Which is actually the case for many of the games I test, because the only time I'm able to play most of these games is when I'm working on VR performance videos like this one. Anyway, for the in-game graphics quality, the 9060XT wasn't quite able to handle the high overall quality preset, so I turned it down to medium, and this is the performance I got. Which, if you ask me, doesn't look half bad. Last up, we have Microsoft Flight Simulator 2020. For those of you asking why Flight Simulator 2020 and not 2024, the short answer is I simply haven't bought 2024 yet. As usual, I set the game's graphics quality settings at their lowest levels with render scaling, world scale, terrain level of detail, and object level of detail at 100. And in order to maintain 72 FPS in this Sedona, Arizona training flight, I had to set the render resolution to 3616 by 1952. Using these same settings in the New York City Discovery flight pushed the 9060XT past its limits as expected, and I saw the frame rate fluctuate between 36 and 60-ish FPS throughout the entire flight. Now, I believe that most people who play Flight Simulator in VR tend to sacrifice frame rate for better visuals, because for the most part, Flight Simulator is slow-paced, and you don't need a super high frame rate. Even going as low as 30 FPS actually works pretty well. So I decided to turn the in-game quality settings up to Ultra, as well as increase the render resolution to 4192 by 2240 to see what the 9060XT could do at those settings. This, of course, improved the visuals a lot, and in both the Sedona, Arizona flight and the New York City flight, I got between 25 and 30 FPS. I flew with reprojection off as well as with it on in both flights, and while the frame rate was the same in both scenarios, gameplay definitely felt smoother with reprojection on. Sure, this produces a bit of a ghosting effect when you turn your head and look around, but it definitely helps improve the experience when the frame rate is super low like this. One question I see from time to time is why do I only talk about a single GPU in videos like this one? And why don't I compare them to other GPUs? Well, there's a couple reasons I do my videos this way. The first one being when I started making these videos, I only had one GPU to test, so there's that. Also, the way I've decided to approach these videos is for them to be more of a guide slash help to let people see what kinds of settings they can get playable performance with from a particular GPU, rather than just showing at this resolution and settings, this GPU got 24 FPS or whatever. In some cases, I feel like that's a disservice to the capabilities of the GPU, but more so, I feel it's a disservice to people who own or are looking to buy a particular GPU, because all that shows them is it didn't do well at the settings I tested at, which may then lead them to think they had to buy a more powerful slash more expensive GPU to be able to play a particular game, which may not be the case at all. I feel it's more helpful to go through the process of dialing things in and finding the best settings to get a playable experience so those watching the video can decide for themselves whether the GPU performs up to their liking or not. That being said, I do see how a comparison list could be very useful. At a quick glance, you can compare the performance of your current GPU to a new one you may be thinking of upgrading to, and help you decide whether it would be a good upgrade or not. Also, when trying to decide between two different GPUs, a comparison list allows you to quickly see which GPU performs better, and by how much, again, helping you make an informed decision. So, for those of you who enjoy charts, here's a list of 10 different GPUs I currently have on hand, and how they stack up against one another in Unigine's Superposition VR benchmark. Each GPU was tested with the per-eye resolution set to 2064x2208, which is the per-eye resolution of the Quest 3. The shaders have been set to VR Future, and the textures to High. I've listed the results from lowest average FPS to highest, and as you can see, the 9060 XT is the second worst performer of the 10 GPUs I benchmarked, but it is also the second cheapest GPU on the list, so it makes sense it doesn't perform as well as GPUs priced higher than it. But hopefully you guys will find this list useful in some way, even if it is only how these GPUs performed relative to one another in this single benchmark. As you can see, the 9060 XT slots right in between the RX 7600 and the RX 7700 XT, and is only around 6 FPS slower than the RTX 5060 Ti 16GB in this benchmark, which is good to know, especially when you consider an RTX 5060 Ti 16GB is currently $50 to $100 more expensive than the 9060 XT, depending on which models you're looking at, of course. Yes, it is true NVIDIA GPUs have better ray tracing performance than AMD, and their DLSS upscaling technology offers better results than FSR. But from stuff I've seen recently comparing the two, FSR 4 is much closer to DLSS than it was when AMD first introduced the technology, so NVIDIA's advantage in that department has narrowed quite a bit. At the time I'm making this video, though, I don't know of any VR games that utilize ray tracing, and only a few that utilize DLSS and or FSR. So if you're looking at the 9060 XT strictly for VR, then I don't think these features should be much of a determining factor for you. But of course, in reality, you're going to be using your PC for much more than just VR. So, depending on the games you play and your budget, the 9060 XT may or may not be the right choice for you. But of course, only you can make that determination. I just hope I've provided you with the information that you need to help you make a decision one way or the other. Come on, do it. You know you want to. Subscribe!